understanding of life, values and culture in the light of life and teachings of Swami Vivekananda. To this effect, we students of IISc meet every week to read and discuss the message of Swami Vivekananda and Indian philosophy in the light of modern thought and modern needs. Those willing to join VSC can type your email address in the chat box after the talk gets over. Q&A session will be conducted after the talk ends. We will start the session with Shanti Mantras and Bhajan by Srimay Mukherjee.
Thank you, Rohit. Am I audible?
Yes.
Shanti Mantra. Om Sahana Vavato Sahano Bhunakto Sah Viryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Ma Vidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 Om Asato Ma Sadgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityor Ma Amritam Gamaya Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu Nirvana Shatkam Mano Buddhi Ahankar Chitani Naham Nacha Shrotra Jive Nacha Grana Netre Nacha Vyoma Bhumi Natejo Navayu Chidananda Rupaha Shivoham Shivoham Chidananda Rupaha Shivoham Shivoham Nacha Prana Sanyo Nave Pancha Vayu Nava Sapta Dhatu Nava Pancha Kosha Navak Pani Pado Nachopastha Payu Chidananda Rupaha Shivoham Shivoham Chidananda Rupaha Shivoham Shivoham Name Dvesharago Name Lobha Moho Mado Naiva Me Naiva Matsarya Bhavaha Na Dharmo Na Charto Na kamo na moksha Chidananda rupaha Shivoham Shivoham Chidananda rupaha शिवोहम् न पुण्यं न पापं न सौख्यं न दुःखं न मन्त्रो न तीर्थ न वेदाहनयज्ञा अहं भोजनं नैव भोज्यं न भोक्ता चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं शिवोऽहं चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं शिवोऽहं न मृत्युर्न शङ्का न मे जातिभेदः पिता नैव मे नैव माता न जन्मा न बन्धु मित्रं गुरुर्नैव शिष्यः चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं शिवोऽहं चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं शिवोऽहं अहं निर्विकल्पो निराकाररूपो विभूत्वा च सर्वत्र सर्वेन्द्रियाणाम् न चासङ्गतं नैव मुक्तिर्न मेऽहं चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं शिवोऽहं चिदानन्दरूपः शिवोऽहं 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 शिवोऽहं
We are glad to present the talk Freedom Here and Now by Swami Shantivardhananji Maharaj. Let me introduce today's speaker for the audience. Revered Swami Shantivardhananji Maharaj is a monk of the Ramakrishna Order and is currently serving at Sri Ramakrishna Ashram, Mysuru. He is an inspiring speaker and delivers talks on personality development, Indian culture, stress management, Indian philosophy, and scriptures. He has presented research papers at many conferences across India and is a frequent contributor of articles on religion and spirituality in Kannada newspapers. He gives talks to state government officers at the Administrative Training Institute, Mysuru, as well as to researchers and professors at UGC Human Resource Academy. Swamiji holds a PhD in philosophy from the University of Mysore. Now I request Swamiji to take over and start the talk.
जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयो श्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः नमः श्रीयतिराजाय विवेकानन्दसूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे. माय डियर members of Vekanda study circle, which is the part of Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru. I'm very happy and also I'm thankful for you people for giving me this wonderful opportunity to address the spiritual aspirants who would like to be free and who would like to understand what is freedom and they would like to be free. And I welcome and I appreciate all the hearers who are spiritual aspirants and the divine beings who want to understand their real nature. And also, it fills my heart with great joy to address in this stage Vivekananda Study Circle, because four decades before, my revered Gurudev, most revered Swami Ranganathanji Maharaj, the president, the 13th president of the Ramakrishna Order, was known for Abhinava Vivekananda, who has instrumental in starting this Vivekananda Study Center in the Indian Institute of Science. Being his disciple, I feel it is a deep privilege to address on this stage or for this gathering. My dear all spiritual aspirants and divine beings, as all of you know, today we have assembled here to discuss about freedom here and now. This is the great unique concept given by Indian philosophy, Sanatana Dharma, and with special reference to Advaita Vedanta, Vedanta par excellence. When I thought about this subject, first and foremost, a beautiful, wonderful story came to my mind. The story goes like this. The two young people, named one is Yogendra, the other is Sai Krishna. These are the two people, young guys, young chaps, they were working. But they come from humble background and middle class family. So to support their family and to support themselves, they had to work hard. Every day they used to work hard and they never had any problem for square meal. Their life was going on. After some time, once Yogendra asked the Sai Krishna, "Mr. Krishna, if you don't mind, I would like to ask a personal question with you." Then Sai said, "Yes, you can ask me." Yogendra asked, "See, from long time, I am observing you are having a small casket, a wooden box. You will be holding and you generally you never leave. Wherever you go, generally you try to hold that wooden box. What is that? What it contains? From many days or months, that was there in my mind. Question was there in the mind, but I was thinking whether I can ask or not. So today I was dare enough to open enough to ask. Please, can you reply? If you don't mind, if it doesn't trouble you." Then the Sai Krishna told, "Yes, my dear Yogendra, there is no problem. Even I don't know what is this. I have got this from my father, and my father got from his father, and my grandfather got from great grandfather. From generations it is coming. So probably it holds some holy relics or some holy things. So I never dared to open this. So just as a protocol, as a tradition, as because my father had told this is the great box which has come from generations to us, so you have to take care of this box. We should not leave anywhere. You should not lose this box. So my father had given the last instructions before his passing away. So I am holding and I am trying to protect it." Then the Yogendra asked Sai Krishna, "Why don't we open and see?" Sai Krishna, initially, he was reluctant. And he says, "If I open, there may be a bad omen comes, or the bad things may happen, etc., etc." After a certain amount of discussion, then the Sai Krishna agreed, "Okay, let me open." And he opened. And there, in that small wooden box, there was a small bag, cloth bag. And they opened. There it was 5 or 6 diamonds. My goodness. And each diamond cost is probably lakhs of rupees or crores of rupees. Till now, he, his father, his grandfather, his great-grandfather, they had never opened this wooden box and they were carrying from generations to generation, from one generation to other generation. Just they were handing over, but they never opened the box and they never saw what it contains. If they had seen, if they had sold, they would have been billionaires. Now, when Yogendra instructed, when Yogendra told him, the Sai Krishna opened, and for his astonishment, for both of their astonishment, there were few diamonds. And one diamond, as I said, it cost too much. And 2-3 diamonds he sold, and crores of rupees, the Sai Krishna, he got it, and he became a billionaire. So this is the plight of every one of us, my dear young Indians. Shrunvantu Vishwe Amrutasya putraha ayedamani divyani tastuhu vedaha metam purusham mahantam आदित्य वर्णम तमस परस्तात स्वशेत श्वेताश्वत उपनिषद सेज द ऋषि ही प्रोक्लेम्स देयर यू आर द सन ऑफ इमॉर्टल ब्लिस यू आर द डिवाइन बीइंग्स प्लीज हियर प्लीज अंडरस्टैंड वी आर द इमॉर्टल बीइंग्स we are the divine beings we are not born sinners we are never sinners we are not limited by body mind intellect or so on and so forth but unfortunately we have got limited perceptions we have got limited understandings as a result we have limited our personality and we are struggling suffering enjoying suffering in our life the moment we understand who are we what is our real nature from where I have come from after death wherever I go or what is my real nature what is my true nature what constitutes me what I constitute and the moment I understand I am free that's what the advaita vedanta says you need not to go to swarga you need not to go bhuloka bhuvarloka suvarloka mahaloka janarloka tapaloka or atala vitala tala tala above seven worlds or below seven worlds you need not to go in this mundane world in this bhuloka itself in this earth itself as a born human being you can understand who are you and the moment you realize the moment you experience I am that brahman aham brahmasmi you will be free just like astamalaka they give example in the even shankaracharya's life it comes astamalaka why because amla we know everyone so amla was in the hasta just like if you keep a fruit on your hand how it will be so similarly for a disciple of shankara the moksha or mukti was for him like that it seems means he was a brahmagnani so similarly every one of us we can understand the moment we understand the moment we realize who am I what is my true nature what is my real nature that is that atman or brahman satchit ananda existence conscious absolute the moment we understand we are free this is the whole scheme of our talk what is freedom why we need freedom how to attain freedom and how can be attained here in this world and now itself this will be the talk or the points which I'll be going to discuss in the coming time there's a beautiful saying said by Swami Vivekananda all that we see in the universe as for its basis this one struggle towards freedom it is under the impulsive of this tendency that the saint prays and the robber robs when the life of action is not a proper one we call it evil and when the manifestation of its proper and high we call it good but the impulse is the same the struggle towards freedom that's what Swami Vivekananda says unquote and he also says the amoeba slowly it has evolved itself to human being how it has evolved what it made to evolve they say Swami Vivekananda says it is nothing but freedom because the amoeba wanted to expand itself the amoeba wanted to expand it was slowly from unicellular organism it became multicellular organism so on and so forth and finally it reached the human being and finally it also reaches the same amoeba will reaches the Buddha state why because every being every conscious being knowingly or unknowingly it is trying to strive for the freedom it is seeking the freedom but unfortunately no the wise people they know what is freedom and from where to get it the dull headed people or the unwise people the ignorant people they don't know where is freedom and how can we get freedom so they are groping in the darkness so freedom is the hallmark of the life we have got different shades of meaning in the freedom just for an example if you see the youths today's youths what is freedom if you ask oh swamiji we need freedom because we have grown up we are no more high school students we are college students we are graduates we are post graduates or we are pursuing phd so we are grown up people so we need freedom okay what do you mean by freedom if you ask the youngsters they say swamiji our parents should not ask us anything the parents should not question about us similarly when we go to college when we go to universities our teachers also should not question the elders should not question us the people should not tell us what to do and what not to do because we want freedom that's what it means privileges without responsibilities are free living still in a just one word if you want to tell the adolescent people and the youths they define the freedom as they want to have the life merrymaking or according to their interest according to their living that is what free living but this is not the real meaning of freedom it is called swechachara in Kannada it is got free living it is animal living basically instinct living because if you have got a for an example a dog in the house its name is probably Tommy you will never ask oh Tommy before drinking milk before taking your morning breakfast have you brushed your teeth are. We don't ask it, why did you do shit in this, in the house itself? Because it has a tailor-made program, it's a biology-made program is there for the dog. Generally, we take out and we allow them to do shit and etc. Instinctively, the animals, they leave. If we are also living at the level of instincts, we have got human body, but we'll be just animals. We are not really human beings. So we are not supposed to leave at the level of instincts. The today, whatever the youngsters have understood, what is freedom, that is free living, or instinct living at the level of instincts, that is not freedom. Then what do you mean by freedom, Swamiji? Swami Vivekananda beautifully, he defines, what is freedom? Freedom means responsibility. Freedom is responsibility. Are you responsible for yourself? Are you responsible for your time? Are you responsible for your life? Are you responsible for your desires, for your passions, for your time, and for your quality life, etc.? Then automatically, the freedom comes to you. That's what Swami Vivekananda says. So freedom means responsibility. Then we have got social freedom, political freedom, so on and so forth, which we are not going to discuss and which is not the part of this lecture today. And we are going to speak of spiritual freedom. Before entering into the spiritual freedom, I would like to discuss the difference between external freedom and the difference between the internal freedom. Today, if you see from the old stone age to the present day, if you see, human being is growing and is getting evolved physically, mentally, intellectually, and even at the level of science and technology or industrial revolution, so on and so forth. He has devised new devices, he has made comfortable life, with the help of new technology, many things he's doing. He's trying to control over the nature. He's trying to have the mastery over the nature, which has given a lot of benefits, which has given a lot of good for us, which has given a lot of privileges for us, no doubt. But at the same time, unhealthy competition, might for right tendency, all these things also have come in the mindset of the society, of the people, and unhealthy competition, kicking someone, or just because I have to leave, I will suck the blood of common people or the poor people. Such type of evil tendency, evil mindedness also has cropped in the human mankind. This is of science and technology, which is used in a wrong way. So if you have got control over the external nature, that is not the real mastery, that is not real freedom. Because when we have a control over the external nature, I have got the mastery over the external nature, but generally, I will not have a mastery over my internal nature. As a result, there will be a lot of problems, a lot of dangers, or the species will be endangered, society may be get endangered, people will be killed unnecessarily, people will be taken for task unnecessarily, which we are seeing in the present day society. So that's why external freedom is not the real freedom, internal freedom is the real freedom. Still, to make my point very clear, I would like to discuss. For an example, a student will think, okay, if after my graduation, there will be no more study, there will be no more reading, there will be no more assignments, there will be no more appearing in the exam. So once my exams are over, once my graduation or post-graduation is over, I feel I am free. But once he finishes his education, that is graduation or post-graduation, when he goes for working, when he goes into the work, then he understands that student life was the golden life. Student life is the golden life. Probably we should, that was the better. Yeah. At the same time, a politician thinks, if I become MLA, if I become an MP, if I become a minister, if I become a CM or PM, I will be free because my power will be a lot of, I will have a power and I can do anything and everything and I will be the free person. I will have absolute freedom. Once he becomes the CM or PM, he will understand that, no, it is not. Similarly, a business entrepreneur thinks that once I become rich person, once I become thousand, once I earn lakhs of rupees or crores of rupees, I will be free. If I can extend my business to the larger area, I will be free, he thinks. After some time, he understands that he may get partial freedom. He may get little name and fame, he may get little power and position, etc., but really he will not get complete freedom or he will not get a real freedom. So similarly, a celebrity thinks before attaining a good name and fame, he thinks that if I become a celebrity, as for an example, film actor, a sportsman, once I achieve in my own field, then I'll be a free person. I can do anything and everything, etc. but after some achievements, he will understand, no, it is not so. After achieving so many things, I am getting more and more binded, but I will not be, I am not real freedom. So we may get partial freedom here, but I don't get real freedom, or I don't get complete freedom in all these things. So when I try to achieve mastery over, control over the external things, I will get amount of happiness, I may get amount of pleasure, I may get amount of desires fulfilling, etc., etc., but real freedom or complete freedom I can never get. This we have to understand. So this is the thing Swami Vivekananda says, this idea seen clearly in the West. What is that? They have spent most of their time and energy in discovering the external nature, going into the depths of ocean, flying into another planets, and so on and so forth, but they have not achieved the real freedom in toto. Whereas Indian sages, Indian people, they did try exploring the nature, exploring the prakriti, and they did attain many things externally. But after some time, they understood that how much ever I may claim, or how much ever I have got the external accomplishments, that is not the real freedom. Freedom, that is, I have got a lot of limitations. They understood, and they started discovering where is that then real freedom? Where is the real freedom? Where is the real freedom? Slowly they went inside. That's what Kathopanishad beautifully portrays. Paranchikani vitrunat svayambhu parang paschati nantaratman kaschit dhiraga atmanam ekshat avrutta chaktur amrutattvam icchan. They went inside and they understood that the real freedom is when I understand myself. The real freedom is because everything is here only, inside is only. That is what the my real nature, the moment I understand who am I, what am I, what I am made up of, etc., etc., then the real freedom I'll get it. They understood and they went inside. That's what Swami Vivekananda gives a beautiful analogy or beautiful description of the Western civilization as well as Eastern civilization, or with special reference to the Indian civilization. So control over the people, control over the animals, or control over the nature and the freedom, many times we have misunderstood. So we should not misunderstand. There's a lot of difference between control and freedom. Control may be necessary, but that is not the alpha and omega of the freedom. So science is trying to control the forces, whereas the spiritual science, the spirituality or the religion is trying to make us free. It is not trying to control the nature. It is making us, it is showing the way or path to make us free. Now, what is this internal freedom? How we can attain internal freedom? And what is the barricade? What is not allowing us to be free internally, or moksha or mukti? Beautifully, in the Bhagavad Gita, Adi Shankaracharya, before starting the Bhashya in the Sankhya Yoga, he puts that. He explains the samsara. He explains the problem of samsara, keeping the Arjuna as a nimitta. He says, raga, shoka, and moha. Raga is attachment, moha is delusion, shoka is unhappiness. This is the problem of, or this is the nature of samsara. We all feel sometimes we are good, sometimes we are bad. Sometimes we are happy, sometimes we are unhappy. Sometimes we are joyful and sometimes we are morose. So this type of, we are bound in the duality and we are struggling. We are grouping in the darkness basically. Why? Because we are stuck in the samsara. So what is that nature of samsara? That is raga, shoka, and moha. That is the nature of shoka. Because we are attached ourselves either to the sense objects, to the pleasure seeking objects, or for our mind, for our intellect, for our passion, so-called worldly passions, etc. That's why that is what raga. Due to the attachment, what is happening? When we are able to fulfill our desires, then we will be happy. The moment when we are not able to fulfill our desires, then what happens? We get unhappiness. Today, stress and strain, today a lot of morose, and suicidal attempts are increasing. Why? Because they might have got external accomplishments, but they are not happy inside. They feel there is a lot of vacuum inside. That is why maybe they may be engineers, they may be doctors, they may be IPS officers, they have got anything and everything in their life externally, but inside there's a vacuum. That's why, because they're away from their nature, that's why the suicidal tendency is increasing. Depression, the cases of depression is also ever increasing. Why? Because of raga and moha, shoka has taken over their mind. The moment we have got attachment, our mind is deluded, the moment when our mind is deluded, we don't know what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is bad, what should I do, what should I not do, when should I do, when should I not do, why should I do, why should I not do. Such type of discrimination, we will lose the discrimination, the faculty of discrimination will be pushed aside. That's why we will get the moha. When the moha get, we do unwanted things, or we don't know what to do and what not to do. We in the confused state, we'll be struggling. Most of the time, we will live the life of morose. That is what the shoka. This is what the samsara. Now, fortunately and unfortunately, every one of us, we have struck in the samsara. From the small child to the old person, every one of us, we have struck in the samsara. Samsara is not just, I am marrying, I have got a wife, I have got a kith and kin. It is not samsara. Many times in the local vernacular languages, that's how the samsara is described. But samsara means having birth and death. I mean, getting victimized in the cycle of birth and death, that is what samsara. Why this samsara happens? Because of raga, moha, and shoka. The attachment to the world and worldly objects, it creates a delusion. Because we have got deluded, that's why we are suffering. But our real nature is what? Sat Chit Ananda. That's what Upanishad said. Satyam Gnanam Anantam Brahma, Sat Chit Ananda, Aham Brahma, Smitattvam Asi, Ayamatma Brahma, Pradhanam Brahma. All these things are told by Upanishads in it. Just the same idea is conveyed in the different way. What is that? I am existence, knowledge, bliss, absolute. That is my true nature. That is not my character. That is not my guna. That is not my character. That is not the adjectives of the soul or of the self, of the Atman or Brahman. That is the nature. That is the nature of every being, of every soul, or of the self, or of the Atman or Brahman. The moment I understand, I will be free. I may be a son of Mukesh Ambani, or I may be a son of beggar. I may be a politician, or I may be a common person who is struggling to just to take care of my life, but I can be blissful at all circumstances, at all situations, with all people, and at all times. That is the beauty of this Vedanta. That is the beauty of Atmajnana. That is the beauty of Brahmajnana. Why should I get Atmajnana? Why should I get Brahmajnana? Because you can live the happiest life, blissful life. Now you say, Swamiji, now I have earned a lot of money. Now I am so-and-so, I am son of millionaire or billionaire. Then why should I seek for this Brahmajnana? Why should I seek for self-knowledge? Why should I seek for Atmajnana? You may question. I would like to answer for an example. Now Corona is there, this Corona pandemic situation. Many of us, we are worried whether today or tomorrow Corona may affect us. What will happen for us? Whether I may die, or my kith and kin may die, my wife may die, my children may die, my parents may die, my relatives may die, my close friends may die. I may be a millionaire, I may be a billionaire, I am leading a beautiful life with all external accomplishments, but still, this one small corona, the small virus is trying to shake me. Why? Because I am in the realm of Maya. Because I am in the realm of samsara. I may have a lot of external accomplishments, but when the abhinivesha, the fear of death comes, when these external situations which becomes unfavorable, I will be shaky and I will be fearful. That's why, that means what? I will not be really free from all these things. That's why I may have external accomplishments. Of course, I don't say that, or Vedanta doesn't say that you should never strive for all the external accomplishments, external achievements. You may do it, but understand clearly what is the role of it and what is the place in your life. Understand, and just to take care of your external life, to take care of your mundane life, you may strive, you may struggle for that, but understand, who are you? We can see in the King Janaka's life, he was a king. He was ruling the kingdom. As a king, whatever he was supposed to do, all the duties he was doing, but in the heart of heart, he knew that I am the Atman, I am the Brahman. I doesn't depend onto these people, or to my subjects, or to this kingdom, or to this kingship, and nothing of these things belongs to me, because I am that Atman or Brahman. Shivoham, Shivoham, Shivoham. He knew beautifully this, and knowingly, he was ruling the kingdom. That's the beauty of Vedanta. Even after Atmajnana or Brahmajnana, I can do anything and everything. If I was a butcher, I can continue my profession. If I am a business entrepreneur, I can continue as a business person. If I am an IAS officer, even after Atmajnana, I can try to take care of the particular area, whichever the work was assigned, I can continue, but there will be no more delusion. Internally, I'll be completely free. That's why we need freedom. That's why we need moksha, or that's why we need mukti. And one more thing is, why we need mukti is because from this samsara, that is cycle of birth and death, we will be free. Again, you may say, Swamiji, I am happy. Why should I? Kartrutva, bhoktrutva, karta, bhokta, and jnata. These are the three things which we have to understand. What is, first is bhokta. Bhokta is always the person who is struck with this bhoktrutva bhava. That bhoktrutva bhava is enjoyer, enjoyership. Okay, I did so much work, so people should give me so much respect. I did so much work, the company should pay me so much, etc., etc. So one who is always thinking about the enjoyment, he will be struck in his life. He cannot achieve many things. A common person, generally, if you see any mediocre person, a common person always will be struck with this bhoktrutva bhava. Bhoktrutva bodhe, bita bhoktrutva bhava or bhoktrutva bodhe. Whereas the achievers, if you see, like maybe Abdul Kalam, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, such type of people, whoever achieved in their particular fields, generally they will have kartrutva bhava, kartrutva bodhe more. What do you mean by that? They spend their time and they always spend their energy in achieving things. Okay, that is my target. I want to accomplish. I want to achieve it. Okay, this is my goal. I will struggle. How long? Till reaching my goal. So these people are always, they don't bother with fruits of action. They don't think much about fruit. They don't think much about results. Once in a while they may think, but they don't bother much about it. Rather, they always struggle just to achieve their goals, achieve their targets, and reach their goals or targets. These people are generally little higher. And the jnata. Jnata is the person who tries to always understand, who am I? For example, we can see in the life of Ramana Maharshi. A spiritual aspirant goes. He says, Venerable Sir, sometimes I'm happy. Sometimes I'm unhappy. I've achieved so many things. And I'm supposed to achieve this. These are the things which I have not attended, which I have not yet achieved. All these things I'm struggling in my own life, in my own humble way. How much ever I've struggled, but still I'm not happy. What to do? This was the question posed by a spiritual aspirant to the Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi gives a beautiful answer. You achieved so many things, you are saying, and you are saying that you are supposed to achieve so many things. That's all fine. These are all upadis. These are only external accomplishments or external upadis. So I have to achieve and I am supposed to achieve. I have not yet achieved. All this in this business, there is a one I, there is a one Sakshi, there is a one notion of I. That is what that Atman. Try to find out who is that I. The moment you understand, the moment you find out who is that I, then you will be the happiest person. This was the answer given by Ramana Maharshi. Then the spiritual aspirant thinking was open and he understood, yes, I achieved this. I didn't achieve this. I did this. I didn't do this. I went. I didn't. I did go. I went or I go. I go. I didn't go, etc., etc. Generally, in the mundane affairs, in the everyday transactions, we'll be telling all the times, but we don't try to understand. Who is that I? In all these things, from my childhood till my death, there will be a lot of changes physically, lot of changes mentally, lot of changes emotionally, lot of changes intellectually, isn't it? But the notion of I is constant. From my birth to death, the notion of I is constant. That we have to hold on and that we have to understand, who am I? The moment I understand, then I'll be completely free. I'll be free. That's what the Vedanta says. That's why we have to seek for freedom. Why? Because to be free from all these things, I may be a prime minister, I may be a Tata Birla, I may be a Mukesh Ambani, or I may be a great film star, etc., but I may achieve many things externally. You may achieve also. We don't say no, but that is not the alpha and omega of life. That should not be the alpha and omega of life. Because whatever you may achieve, that is groping in the darkness. The manifestation of your existence, Sat, manifestation of Chit, the consciousness, manifestation of the bliss, that is Ananda, it is partial in all the so-called external accomplishments. That's why the Ananda is also partial there. The freedom is also partial there. The moment, for example, you are a business entrepreneur, you have achieved many things. The moment one more business entrepreneur is coming and he's achieving many things, the moment you see, you will feel the problem. You will feel jealousy of him. You will feel problem. The fear may come and you will see that whether he may take over me, he may cross over me, etc., etc. All these things we can see in the mundane life, in every field, with every person. Why? Because there is an internal insecurity. Why? Because we don't know who am I. If you have to get the internal security, what should I do? The Vedanta says that understand who are you. That's why na karmana, na prajaya, na dhanena, tyage naike, amrutatva manushu. Na karmana, how much ever you may do, best actions, you cannot attain this realization. Na karmana, na prajaya. You have a wonderful progeny and you have got a lot of fan following, but still from that atmajnana, self-knowledge, you will not. Na karmana, na prajaya, na dhanena. You are a crorepati, but still self-knowledge is not possible. Tyage naike, amrutatva manushu. Through renunciation alone, you can understand what is that? Who am I? Renunciation means what? You have to renounce the world and you have to become a monk or mendicant and you have to join the ashrama. The renunciation, we say that. No, we are not saying that renunciation. The renunciation of ahankara and mamakara, that is I-ness and minus. The small I, the I-ness connected with the body, mind, complex, that you should renounce the I-ness and minus, ahankara and mamakara. The moment you renounce it, then you will be free. Amritatva, you'll get it. That's what? Immortality, you can get it. That's why, that is what real freedom. Now, the Advaita says that you may say you are free or you are happy, etc., etc. That will be always in the limited time. It is just like a buy one, get one free. Today I am happy. Tomorrow I am happy. Day after tomorrow I am happy. For 1 week I am happy. But there is no assurance. There is no guarantee after a week you will be happy. And it is certain that you cannot be happy. After some time, there will be some situation, there will be some problem which disturbs your mind, your happiness goes away. So whatever I externally accomplish, the happiness, the peace, whatever I get, that will not be for a long time. It is disturbing or it is limited in nature. Whereas when I say that I want happiness, I want bliss, I want ananda, and I don't want unhappiness, etc., etc. Just every one of us, we are trying to achieve that. The Advaita Vedanta says that why you should come to Advaita Vedanta. What is the goal of Advaita Vedanta? If you ask, it says, Atyantika Dukkha Nivrutti and Paramananda Prapti. Atyantika Dukkha Nivrutti means what? Cessation of all suffering. Complete cessation of unhappiness and paramananda prapti. Attainment of complete happiness or bliss at all times. Okay, today is there, tomorrow is there, day after tomorrow is there, afterwards it is not there, no. Or yesterday, a day before yesterday, for 1 week it was there, today it is not there, no. At all times I should be happy. At all times I should be blissful. There is the state. That is what the Jivan Mukta state. That is what the real freedom. That's why that is the goal of the Advaita Vedanta. Atyantika Dukkha Nivrutti and Paramananda Prapti. So why should I come to Advaita Vedanta? Why should I come to spiritual life? Why should I seek for self-realization? Why should I seek for moksha? Why should I seek for mukti? Why should I seek for nirvana? Why should I seek for kaivalya? Leaving all these things. Because the goal, the aim and the goal of the Vedanta, with special reference to Advaita Vedanta, is Atyantika Dukkha Nivrutti and Paramananda Prapti. That's why we need Vedanta. That's why we need self-realization. That's why we need moksha. That's why we need mukti. Isn't it? So, and also freedom. If you see in the other systems of philosophy, of course, in the Charvaka, they never believe in all this moksha and mukti. If you see in the Jainism and Buddhism, attaining the jina is the freedom for them, and attaining the bodhisattva is the freedom for the Jains and Buddhists. If you see the Sankhya and Yoga, how do they define the freedom? For them, disassociation of purusha from prakriti, dissociation of oneself, that is my dissociation of me from this prakriti and its evolutes is the freedom for them. If you see the Nyaya and Vaisheshika, what is the freedom for them? The freedom is going beyond this cycle of samsara, going beyond good and bad, right, wrong, sorrow and happiness is what moksha or mukti. That's what they say. That's what apavarga they say. And if you see Purva Mimamsa, what is this? Generally, in the Purva Mimamsa, that is Karmakanda, in the Purva Mimamsa, how do they define freedom for them. Freedom is attaining heaven, attaining Pitruloka, attaining Gandharva Loka. So attaining the higher worlds and enjoying there, that is the freedom for them. That is what the Mukti. And in the later Mimamsakas also accept different idea of moksha. That is a complete cessation of, complete absence of sorrow and suffering. That's what they say. But if you see the Purva Mimamsa in the Karmakanda portion, they tell very clearly that attaining the Swarga or the above worlds is what moksha or mukti are. That is what the freedom. This, the same thing we can see in the Semitic religions, either in the Christianity or in the Islam. Mostly, even they also, the final judgment, we have to do all the good things. Why? Because the final judgment, God judges our good actions and bad actions. If bad actions are more, we'll be thrown to the permanently to the hell. And if good actions more, and we'll be thrown to the, we'll be sent to the heaven permanently. That's why we are supposed to do good and bad. Because they don't believe in Punarjanma, mostly in the Islam and Christianity. So in the Semitic religions, there the highest goal of them is attaining heaven, which we see in the theistic schools of Vedanta, and which special reference to the Purva Mimamsa. When coming to the Vedanta, in the different schools of Vedanta, if you see, this Jivan Mukti, as I told already, this Jivan Mukti is the unique concept of Advaita Vedanta only. Of course, Sikhism also accepts this Jivan Mukti. Otherwise, in the Vishishtadvaita and Dvaita, if you see, they don't accept this Jivan Mukti. Rather, they describe the Mukti with the different states of existence, different grades of existence also, like Salokya, Sarupya, Samipya, Sayujyandal. So what is the gist I will mention, and again I will come to Jivan Mukti. Sayujya, that is becoming one with the Lord. There's Brahma Sayujya, Jnani will attain, Ishvara Sayujya, Yogi will attain. These few people only tell. Generally, they tell Salokya. After our death, we go to the Virja through Virja Nadi and all. We get a lot of Punya. If we have got a lot of Punya and if we are a free person, then we will stay with the Lord. The Lord is living in the Vaikuntha or Kailasa, whatever. So even we also live in that world, in that particular planet or particular world with the God itself. Then Sarupya, having the same form as the Lord. This is mainly, predominantly, this concept is in the Vaishnavism. Just like Narayana has got four hands and etc. Even after crossing the Vraja Nadi, we also get such type of, if we are eligible, we are also get such type of Rupa, just like Narayana has got. And we also will have four hands, Kirita, Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Astandal. We will be also living with the Lord himself. That is what Sarupya. And Samipya, living as the attendant or the companion of the Lord is called Samipya. And few scriptures give one more type of freedom, moksha or mukti, is called Sarshti. That is to enjoy the same appliances as Lord. So these are the different freedoms, different types of moksha or muktis is discussed in the theistic schools of Vedanta. That is Vishishtadvaita and Dvaita. Whereas in the Advaita, we never bother for all these things. We never even want all these things. We accept only Jivan Mukti and Krama Mukti. Krama Mukti is doing lot of Upasana, we will go to Brahmaloka, and Brahmaloka doing Shavana Manana Nidhyasana, we will attain the Brahmagnana, Atmagnana, Brahma Sakshatkara, Atma Sakshatkara. Otherwise, Advaita always tells Jivan Mukti. In this world, in this body only, we have to understand who am I, and that is the real goal of life. Beautifully in Viveka Chudamani, we can see Adi Shankaracharya, Shankara Bhagavatpada tells, Durlabham Trayamay Vetad Daivanugrahetukam Manushatvam Mumukshatvam Mahapurusha Samshayaha. What is that? Three things are very unique and very difficult to get it. What is that? Manushyatva, Mumukshatva, Mahapurusha Samshaya. Manushyatva, there is a human body with a humanness, and the Manushyatva and Mumukshatva, seeking for liberation, intense desire for liberation, and Mahapurusha Samshaya, getting close contact with the great people, sages or wise people. So these are the three things which is unique and which is rare indeed. If you can get, your life is blessed. Once you get, what will happen? You will try to realize God, you will try to understand who are you, and you will be the Jivan Mukta. So in the Advaita Vedanta par excellence, we get the bolder affirmations regarding the divinity of man, inner nature, about our perfection, etc. So what is Advaita says about Jivan Mukti and how to attain Jivan Mukti will be again 10-15 minutes of my talk. According to the Advaita Vedanta, and most of the all the religions will accept that innately, actually, in the beginning, at the beginning of the creation, every human being, every individual soul or every jivatma was pure in its nature. Due to somehow or other, it has fallen from its real nature. Even for example, if you see in the Semitic religion, in the Jews or in the Islam and the Christianity, what they say that Adam and Eve, they ate the forbidden fruit. That's the reason they committed a sin, they committed a blunder, but still God excused them and they say he sent them to this earth. That's why we are all original sinners. Whereas Vedanta, we don't believe in this original sin. Means Swamiji beautifully says that they are saying that we have fallen from our true nature, from our real nature. Even theistic schools of Vedanta also tries to explain in a different way. Whereas Advaita Vedanta says that my real nature is Sat, Chit, Ananda, absolute existence, absolute consciousness, and absolute bliss. This is my true real nature, but unfortunately, I have forgotten. What do you mean by a forgotten? Just probably you can remember the story of the two people, the story of Yogendra and the story of Sai Krishna, which I told at the beginning. This is the nature, this is the plight of every one of us. We have understood, we have forgotten about our real nature. Just to make it clear, just to explain a little better way, probably I can give a simple everyday hours experience. Now, we are in the daytime. Of course, now it is evening, you cannot witness. Otherwise, in the daytime, generally we witness the sunlight. Now, a thick patch of clouds comes and they stand in the sky. So, as a result, the sun is covered. A thick patch of white cloud or black cloud is covering the sun. So, sunlight has come. Whatever we were getting the sunlight, it has come down. Now, because I am not able to see the sun, I cannot say that there is no sun. After some time, maybe a few seconds or few minutes or few hours, once the clouds gets dispersed, again I'll be able to see the sun. So similarly, the thick veil of ignorance has covered our true nature. That's why I'm unable to understand, I'm unable to know, I'm unable to realize my true nature. Who am I? What is the true nature? What is my real nature? Is Sat, Chit, Ananda. The moment you understand what is your real nature, then you are free. That's why I can attain this Jivan Mukti or I can attain this freedom here and now and here. Why? The moment you understand who are you are a free person. Your understanding, you means what? It is just not merely intellectual understanding, means experiencing. For example, now you are hearing this Vedantic, that wonderful talk. Now you may feel that, okay, I am not this body, I am not this mind, I am not this intellect, I am not this samskaras, I am not this emotion, I am not this so and so, the person, I have got some name, even I am not so, I am that Atman Brahman. You are understanding. You receive a message, you receive a phone call which was not desired by you. A phone call, a simple message can disturb you. For example, you receive a bad news, passing off your some relatives. Immediately your mind gets disturbed. Till now, you were saying that, okay, after listening to the lecture of Swamiji, I have now understood that I am that Atman, I am that Brahman. The moment you got this news, immediately you start reacting, you start crying, probably you close the lecture and you start going, you start planning how to go and etc. Your mind is agitated, your mind started reacting. You know that now also you are that Atman or Brahman, but your experience is contradicting. Why? I may know intellectually, but it has not become the fact for me because I have not yet experienced. The moment you experience I am that aham brahmasmi, then that means the thick veil of ignorance is dispersed or it has been destroyed. So all of our spiritual practices, all of our sadhana is for what? This is to the removal of this ignorance, to removal of avidya, to removal of the, to destroy the ajnana. A simple one more example I can give, for example, sandalwood. A piece of sandalwood is kept in a vat, in a water for few days, 3 or 4 or 5 days. So there was a stinky smell. You take it and you wipe it and you try to rub on the stone. Initially, you get a bad odor because it was in the water for some time. So a layer has been covered on the sandalwood. However, you try to rub on the stone, it is getting a bad odor. Probably you continue rubbing the sandalwood against the rock. After 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 minutes, again, sandal paste started coming and with a good odor, with a pleasant odor, with a beautiful smell. Earlier, it was not coming. For 2 or 3 minutes, now it started coming because that is the real nature. Because since it came into contact with the water, the sandalwood, it had covered a different layer. That is what mushroom or pachi we say in Canada. So for that reason, that bad odor was coming. The moment it has been removed, so that in its innate nature, real nature, what is that perfume? beautiful perfume started coming. So similarly, our real nature is Satchit Ananda Jnana Pragnanam Brahma or Jnanam Anantam Jnanam Brahma. That is our real nature. Just like the sandalwood was covered by a thin layer which was giving a bad odor. Similarly, a veil of ignorance has covered us. That's why we are unable to understand who am I. That's what Vedanta says. Mala, Vikshepa and Avarna. These are the three doshas which Vedanta says. What is that mala? Dirt. What is the dirt? Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada, Matsarya. Arishad Vargas, we tell. Kama is the desire. Krodha is the anger. Lobha is greediness. Lobha. Moha is delusion. Mada is I can do anything, etc., etc. And Matsarya is jealousy. These are the dirts which is covering our soul. Because since it is covering the mala, what happens? Avarna. This dirt is covering the soul. That is what Avarna Shakti and Vikshepa. It is tossing. It is wrong projections are happening. It is tossing is happening. These are the three doshas which we discuss in the Vedanta. As a result, we are unable to understand who am I. We are unable to know I am the Brahman, Aham Brahmasmi. So Karma Yoga, Dhyana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Raja Yoga, all these yogas, all these spiritual practices, why should I do? Because to remove or to destroy, to remove this mala, vikshepa, avarna, these three types of doshas, defect should be removed. The moment I remove, just I will understand who am I. Still, to give an example, for example, in the olden days, there used to be a lamp, and lamp for that, a chimney used to be there. If a black soot and some dirt, if it is covered, if it is covered in that chimney, then we'll not be able to get the light completed. Probably 10% or 20 or 30 or 40% of light only we'll be getting. The moment we remove the chimney and you clean inside, you remove the black soot and you remove the unwanted dirt, and if you place on the lamp, we get 100% light. Earlier also the light was there, the light was there, but we were not able to get it. Why? Because the inside there was a dirt. The moment we remove the dirt, we are able to receive the complete light. So similarly, the dirt is covering our soul, ourself, our Atman. As a result, we are unable to understand. So we need not to do any new thing. We need not to attain new thing. We need not to achieve new thing. Only just like we cleaned the chimney, the glass chimney, so we have to clean our soul. We have to clean our chitta. That is what mind we say. The moment we clean our mind, just like when the glass chimney was cleared, it was able to reflect the light. The moment our mind is cleansed, it is cleaned, then it can reflect the Atman, the light reflection of the consciousness, then we will be able to understand Aham Brahmasmi. That's why we have to do sadhana. Whatever you do, Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Raja Yoga, Tapa Yoga, Hatha Yoga, whatever the spiritual practices is told by scriptures, why we should do all these things? Because just to clean our mind, to remove the dirt and to destroy the ignorance. And what is this beauty of Jivan Mukti is, I can achieve this Jivan Mukti in this mundane world, and this is possible, and for the human being only. Even for any devas, Gandharva, Seksha, Skinnaras, and all, they can enjoy the life, but they cannot attain the emancipation, they cannot attain the Dhamma Jnana in any other worlds except Brahma Loka. That's why this human birth is the blessed birth. Human life or human body is a blessed body, but unfortunately, we are misusing for so many unwanted things. The moment you understand who am I, nothing can taint you, nothing can afflict you, nothing can bother you. You can be happiest person, you can be the blissful person at all circumstances. Probably you'll be able to understand this clearly when you remember, if you remember the story of Dandamisha and Alexander. Probably most of you know that. Alexander's guru was Aristotle. Aristotle, when Alexander, just when he started his military journey, he asked his teacher Aristotle, "Guru, venerable teacher, I am going to have the victory over the world. Do you need anything?" His teacher, Aristotle, says that, "I have heard that India is the land of Brahmajnanis. India is the land of the born philosopher. If you can bring any one good philosopher, then I would like to discuss with him spirituality, with him the Atmajnana, or whatever, so the knowledge. That's why, if possible, you can bring one philosopher." That is what the Guru Dakshina was asked by Aristotle. Then he said, Alexander said yes. Then he came to Persia, Egypt, and all slowly, and he came to the river, Bias River, that is present Pakistan. Till there only he came. After that, then their people, their soldiers were reluctant to come because there was a huge Magadha kingdom and etc. They were supposed to go back. Then immediately, Alexander remembers, okay, my teacher has asked to bring one philosopher. Okay, let me get it. Then he tells for Pururava, King Pururava, Porus, they say, Pururava, can you get me one Brahmagnani? Or can you get one Sadhu or Bairagya or Brahmagnani, whatever. They have told that. Can you bring? Then the king says, yes, our India is full of Brahmagnanis. Only India is born of philosophers. India is a philosopher's land. You said, as your teacher said, it is right. Okay, I can get it. In every street we get it because we have got a lot of philosophers, a lot of Brahmagnanis. Then during that time, a monk or a mendicant, a sadhu was there, famous by name Dandamisha. So Senadipati, the chief in commander, he goes and approaches saying that, sir, the great emperor, the great Alexander is calling you. He would like to take you for his kingdom. So please come. He says that I will not come. Why should I come? I'm happier. I will not come. Then he was given, saying that we will give so much money, we'll give so many jewels, pearls, diamonds, etc., etc. Can you come? He says no. And they will threaten him, but still he doesn't come. Then this was the first rude shock for the Alexander, a mendicant who doesn't have even a pair of clothes for him on his proper clothes on his body, but still he never bothered, he never feared for the great emperor called Alexander. The whole world was shooking. That's what his perception was there. But a common beggar monk, he says that, I am not bothered about your Alexander the Great, the greatest emperor. I am not bothered. I will not come. That was a rude shock for him. Then he questions the chief in commander, did you say that I have Alexander the Great, I have said, so that he should come? He said, yes, sir, I have told, but he is reluctant to come. Okay, if he wants, how much amount of money he wants, I am ready to give. Pearls, diamonds, etc., etc., did you say that? Yes, sir, I said, but he said, I will not come. Then Alexander said, okay, let me come with you and let me try to bring him back. He also comes, he starts discussing. Then Dandamisha says, so that I am not interested to come with you. Please excuse me. After so much persuasion, then Dandamisha says, okay, I've got some questions. If you answer me properly, and if I get satisfied, convinced, then I'm ready to come with you. Then Alexander nods his head. He said, okay. Then Dandamisha asks, now while going, you will get a big desert, isn't it? Alexander nods his head. Yes, sir, you are right. We get a big desert. So while going, while you are crossing the desert in your horse carriage or whatever, so probably it will take few days. Yes, sir. Then there may be scarcity of food and water, isn't it? Then how are you going to handle? How are you going to manage? Sir, we have got lot of carts of food and carts of water also we are carrying. Don't bother. We will take care of you. If that is your botheration of food and water, don't bother. We are ready to take care of you with enormous amount of food and water. Then this saint Dandamisha, monk Dandamisha said, no, that is not my consideration. That is not my botheration. Okay, still I want to continue with my question. Now, you crossed probably 50 or 60% of the desert. Okay. Your food is almost getting over and you don't have a water now. By whatever, fortunately, unfortunately, whatever water was you were carrying, you and your people, army people have consumed it and it has been finished. Now, what you will do? You will try to get the water, sir. Okay, you are trying so much, you are going east side, west side, north side, south side, everywhere you are going, but still you are not getting a water. Fine. And in opposite side, a person is coming with just a bottle of water. And you are deterred and you want so much, you are thirsty so much, you want just a sip of water. That is the situation. Imagine now, Alexander the Great. Now, a person is coming opposite to you, he has got a bottle of water. What will you do? I will approach him, sir. And I will ask, sir, please give this bottle of water, whatever you want, you give. Okay, the opposite person will question, okay, Alexander, what will you give? Okay, I will give some amount of pearls or diamonds and some gold, etc., etc. He says, no. And then what will you do? Okay, cart load of pearls, diamonds, money, I will give. I will say, sir. And then Dandamisha says that opposite person may not agree with that also. Then he will start, goes on explaining. And he says that whatever I have got, So much cartloads of gold, diamond, pearls, etc., etc., whichever is coming, everything I will give. Oh, please, sir, please give me this bottle of water. That's what I will see finally. That's where the answer was stopped by Alexander. Then Dandamisha, with all laughingly, said, see, all your cartload of heap of gold, diamond, pearls, etc., etc., all these comes just to a bottle of water. Now, here, beautiful water is a river is flowing, I get to quench my thirst, it is enough, and to quench my hunger, I've got wonderful God given forest where I've got lot of delicious fruits. So to quench my thirst and to quench my hunger, God has given anything and everything. Why should I come with you? I will not come. All whatever you have got pleasures and whatever you have got so much amount of gold and etc., etc., just it comes equal to the bottle of water, isn't it? So this was the answer was given by Dandamisha. How he was able to give such type of answer? Because he was very firm in his answer. And afterwards, Alexander, he tries to threaten him, but still he says, I will kill you, he says that. Then Dandamisha says that, you are the big liar, you are telling the big lie, because I am that Atman, no one kill me. Nainam chindanti shastrani, nainam dhati pavakaha, nachainam kledayantyapto, nashoshayite marupa. No weapon can kill me, no fire can burn me, no water can wet me, no air can dry me. That is my real nature. Chidananda, shivoham, shivoham, shivoham. If you can do, can you do a small favor, help? He, Dandamisha, after telling this, he asks Alexander, what sir, if you can just come aside, then the sunlight will fall on me. Because of this winter, I will be able to enjoy the sunlight. So please get out of my way, he tells. Finally, Alexander understands the whatever he has achieved, everything has been just a speck of dust in front of Dandamisha, he understands. And the Alexander starts moving, and Alexander's mind changes from that time. That's what the historian says. So does Dandamisha, how he was able to face that Alexander, the great king, even the greater king, greatest kings were, they were fearing when they heard or when they saw Alexander. But a mendicant, a beggar, penniless beggar, Dandamisha, he never bothered, he never feared by seeing Alexander. Why? Because of Atma Bala. That is the beauty of Atma Bala. That is the beauty of the power of Atman. Swamiji tells again and again, Swami Vivekananda, Atma Shakti is the highest Shakti. The spiritual power is the highest power. Once you get, no, in the world, nothing can shake it. Nothing can come near to it. That's why Dandamisha was there, because he was a Jivan Mukta. The moment you are a Jivan Mukta, nothing can change you. Nothing can taint you. Nothing can afflict you. No thing or no person, no situation will have a control over the mind. You will have a self-mastery. For example, I'm riding a horse. I am supposed to be the master over the horse. But most of the time, what happens in our day-to-day thing, a horse will lead us. Just like senses. I am supposed to be the master over master of my senses, master of my mind, master of my intellect. But unfortunately, my senses are pulling me wherever it wants, wherever it desires, and I am following it. Just like if my mind is pulling me, wherever it desires, I am following my mind. So similarly with the emotions, etc. I am supposed to be master over my body, mind, intellect, desires and emotions, but I am the slave of all these things. Once I understand who am I will be the mastery, I will be the master over all these things, because nothing of these things will taint and they will lose all their powers. Generally, we say, oh, Swamiji, mind is very turbulent. We cannot control the mind. Mind is naturally, by its nature, it is restless. How to control the mind? How to curb its restlessness, etc., etc.? This is the age-old question asked by, started from Arjuna till now. All these things will be taken care of the moment you understand, who are you, who are you, who are you, or who am I, who am I, who am I. So the world no longer deludes you. That is the state of Jivan Mukta. And after your prarabdha karma is over, this body will fall off. Just like I remove the garment tomorrow morning, I remove this garment and I wear the fresh garment similarly. So this body will fall off and I am. Or just I will be with my true nature. Who is that? I am that Aham Brahmasmi or Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma. To understand that only we are struggling. But unfortunately, known people are struggling in the right way. Dull-headed people or ignorant people are trying to find out the real freedom or reality or for real existence, real knowledge, real bliss, real consciousness in the wrong direction. That's why Advaita Vedanta says that the moment you understand who are you, that you will be free and you will be happiest person, you will be blissful person. That is not in the swarga, that is not in the wealth, that is not in the prajani, that is not in the name and fame, that is not in the pavan position, that is in you only. And that is you only. That is not in you only. That is you only. The moment you understand, you are free, you are mukta purusha. That is what kaivalya, that is what moksha, that is what mukti, that is what nirvana, etc., etc. Jivan. The moment I understand, I'll be free from this cycle of samsara. That is what cycle of birth and death. That is the real goal of the human being, as Sri Ramakrishna says. So the moment I understand who am I am free. Now and here only. This is what the state of Jivan Mukta, which is told by Advaita Vedanta. And every account of Advaita Vedanta, every one of us, knowingly or unknowingly, consciously or unconsciously, we are struggling to be the Mukta Purusha, Jivan Mukta Purushas. Some are aware of it and some are unaware of it. Let Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother Sharda Devi, Swami Vekananda and our Gurudev, let they shower their blessings on all of us, so that let us take the spiritual path and let us consciously understand who are we, what is our real nature, and let us experience and let us get out from the cycle of samsara. So from Buddha we have to travel to the Buddhu, from Buddhu we have to travel to Buddha, that is enlightened person. From traveling, what is Advaita teaches? If you see that is what the mental phenomena, we travel from what to so what, what to so what, what, why it happened, what we answer. When the moment you understand who are you, so what, that's all simple. From we will travel from what to so what, that is what mukti, or that's what jivan mukti. Let the holy trio shower their blessings on all of us, so that we shall tread the spiritual path and let us understand who am I or who are we. Thank you for patient hearing.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Wonderful talk. We learned a lot from this. Now let's start the Q&A session.
Okay.
Those who have questions, either please raise hands. We'll unmute you and you can ask the question, or you can type the question in the chat box.
So Sudipto, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask the question.
I have one question. My question is that when we hear these things, we feel very good, but how to realize and make it a living reality? Means how to improve the practical day-to-day life? How can we implement these things in our day-to-day life?
Yeah, two, three things. Because though we know all these things, we are not able to put into practice, or it has not become the fact, or it has not become the experience, because of already I told in the middle of my talk, because of the chitta mala, that is of impurities. The moment you clean your impurities, the moment you clean your mind, you'll be able to understand who are you, what is your true nature, real nature. By karma yoga, you'll be able to have a chitta shuddhi, and from upasana, you'll get a chitta ekagrata, and from jnana yoga, that is shravana, manana, nidhyasana, you'll be able to get the brahmakara vritti, or the jnana, who are we or who am I, and you'll be able to understand. This is the Advaita Vedanta's sadhana scheme it has been given. Either you do upasana, practice japa, meditation, control over the mind, and try to lead the ethical life, try to lead a pure life, that's the one thing. And try to remember always who am I, always we should try to remember, and we should try to consciously cogitate. Then slowly we'll be able to, by sheer practice, by constant practice, by qualitative constant practice, we'll be able to understand who are we. That's what the sadhana is called, spiritual sadhana. For the chitta shuddhi has to happen. Till chitta shuddhi happens, we will not be able to understand. How much ever you may listen lectures, you will not be able to understand, you will not be able to experience. The chitta shuddhi has to happen. You have to remove all your doubts. Yeah, you are clear?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have another question. Sudeep, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yeah. Hello, Maharaj. Namaskar.
Hello. Namaste.
Maharaj, I want to ask that, what you are telling, I listen. So, the enlightenment is our final goal.
Yeah. Yes.
So, means I remain to be confident that what I will do, or who am I? These questions that who am I, or what is the purpose of my life?
Mm-hmm.
So I remain to be confused with these questions. So means I don't know, I don't understand that by getting also enlightenment, what will I do? Why it is the aim? That also I don't understand.
Yeah, I think I told in my in the middle of the talk, why should I seek for enlightenment? Why should I desire for enlightenment? Is because I will be free from all this samsara. That is, what is that samsara? Raga, shoka, I mean raga, moha and shoka. Sometimes I'm happy and sometimes unhappy. Sometimes I feel I'm good and sometimes I'm bad. Sometimes I feel I'm okay and sometimes I'm not okay. First type of duality is there at every moment and every second or every hour and at every part of life. So to get out from this, to transcend from all these physical problems, mental problems, intellectual problems, it is not getting away from the problems. It is transcending ourselves from these problems, from the samsara. We should seek for freedom. The freedom is what? Completely free. Completely free from what? I may be in earth. I may be in this mundane world. I may be continue whatever I was doing. If you are a lecturer, you continue your work. If you are a minister, you continue your work. If you are a business entrepreneur, you can continue your work, but you will be a free person. Now I am a bound person. That's why I struggle. I suffer. The moment you understand who are you, then obviously, automatically, nothing will bind you. You can be at all times, at all circumstances, with everyone, you can be happiest person. You will be the blissful person. That's why you have to seek freedom. That's why you need enlightenment. That's what the traveling from Buddha to Buddha is nothing but the spiritual life or sadhana. Is it clear for you?
Yeah, but can I ask a related question?
Yeah.
Maharaj, so then if I am not becoming happy and unhappy simultaneously, okay, then my sensitivity has gone, right?
Again, the beautiful question you asked. Nice. It is not that because neither I am happy or unhappy, neither I don't feel any dualities. So whether I will be like just like rock, like I will become an inert object. No, that is not the state of such type of thing. It is a state of positivity. It is a state of bliss. It is a complete bliss. Just what I told. So the traveling from what to so what is nothing but the Advaita. I may help people. For example, someone is suffering. By seeing that, I will feel ayo. I will feel pity or I will feel sorrow for them. I will feel morose for them. And I will definitely, as much as possible, in my strength, whatever is possible, I will try to help them. Such type of will be there. But I will be free from all dualities. Because we have been experiencing this duality every day, that's why we understand or we feel that is the part and parcel of life. Without that, we cannot be happy or we cannot be blissful. That is the wrong notion, wrong understanding which we have got.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Hari Om Maharaj. Jairam Krishna. Maharaj?
Yeah.
Maharaj, like Advaita.
Okay.
The freedom. Something like, you know, I, like when you were giving lecture, I started thinking. Something like, I want a freedom from the freedom. I meant to say.
Okay. Like, even the freedom, I want the freedom from the freedom. Okay.
Yeah. So something, even if I associate myself with any other, Madhidvipa, Vaikuntha, Kailas, anywhere, even that creates a duality, okay. Sometimes with the Devi, sometimes with the Vishnu, even that also should eliminate.
Yeah, that's what I see. I mean, this Vaikuntha, Swarga, all this, the different worlds, attaining is Samipya, Saropya, Salokya and all, that is called by Vishishtadvaita or Dvaita, theistic schools of Vedanta. In the Advaita Vedanta, non-dual school of Vedanta, we don't advocate that. We don't even encourage. According to us, Jivan Mukti is the only thing which we always advocate and which we support and which we encourage. My real nature is free. My real nature is that freedom that can be attained here and now. So that is my goal of my life, and for that only I'm struggling it. You understand? Going to different worlds, and there I'm becoming a Devata, there becoming a Indra, Varuna, Rudra, Shashanka, or some Deva, Devi, Yaksha, Kinnara. No, that is not our goal at all. Our goal is to be free, to Atmavita, to understand Brahmagnani, to understand who am I, and I to be free completely at all times, at all places, all worlds. From all worlds, not at all worlds, from all worlds.
Yeah, Maharaj, but now in this present, much in this present state of mind, so I want some freedom. So the moment if, when I get a freedom, can how can I define that, what kind of state that is like?
Yeah, that's what we. I've told you, na. The what is the nature of that freedom and what is the state of the freedom is complete bliss, complete happiness. And the moment you attain that freedom, there will be no person to tell, okay, this is freedom, and the like gnata gneya we say, gnata gneya and gnana. So experiencer experienced, isn't it? For example, I am happy means I am there. And experiencing, I am happy, the experiencer and experiencing is there, isn't it? When you attain that the complete freedom or Jivan Mukta, Viveka Jivan Mukti, there will be no one to tell that I am free, because I am always free, that I will be my real nature. Just for example, in the deep sleep. If you are in the deep sleep, you will not be able to tell that I am in the deep sleep. If you are sleeping and if you say that I am in deep sleep, that means you are not in the deep sleep, isn't it? Yeah. Once you come out from the deep sleep, and if you come away from the sleep only, you'll be able to tell that I was in the deep sleep. So similarly, if I come out from the Advaita position, or from that, at least the experiencing of that I am Aham Brahmasmi, then only you'll be able to tell I experienced that state of consciousness, I experienced that Jivan Mukti Avastha, I experienced that Aham Brahmasmi, etc., etc. When you are experiencing that, you will not be the person, individual person, you'll be merged in that. Because yourself, you'll be the experiencer and experienced and experience. Everything will be merged there. There will be only one. Isn't it? Just like in the sleep and sleeper was no two different things. If it is two different, that will not be a deep sleep. So similarly, when you are experiencing the Atma Jnana or Brahma Jnana, experiencer, experienced, and action called experience will not be there. There will be only one awareness. This is all Aham Brahmasmi, Tattvamasmi, I am Atma Brahma, just to make us understand our scriptures have said. That's all.
Maharaj, is it something like I'm striving for the awareness, then losing the awareness of yoga?
Can you just little speak loudly? I'm not able to hear clearly for you.
Yeah, Maharaj, in the beginning period of time, while doing the sadhana, we'll strive for the blissfulness. I want consciousness, I want Vishwaprajna, a lot of things. Then the moment we go to that, even losing the all, like even the striving for the blissful nature also, that will also become a bond. That will also become duality. Even leaving that also is the mukti.
Okay. Now, your question is like, initially I will be struggling for attaining the freedom or attaining the bliss. Once I attain the bliss, all these things will go away, isn't it? Even that is also duality according to you.
Yes, sir.
No, there is no question of duality at all. Because again, I am telling you, this point probably you are not able to understand. Because the moksha or mukti is not an object. Okay, it is a subject, because we objectify the world. That's the whole problem is, because mind, for mind, name and form is required. Name and form, it is not. Similarly, moksha mukti, if we say that it is some place or it is some object to achieve, we feel. So the moksha or mukti is not an object to be achieved, rather it is awareness. It is a consciousness. So there will be no duality at all. Why you want duality? Once your duality is crushed, then you'll be the experiencer, you'll be the experiencing, you'll be the experienced, and there'll be no distinction at all. So there will be no duality at all.
Okay. Okay. Then last question. The moment when a person gets a freedom, then he can be called as a Vishwa. He becomes one with the universe.
He can be called Shiva. He can be called Shiva, no doubt. But the powers of Shiva, the creation, sustenance, and the destruction of the world, whatever we say in the Puranic language, that he cannot get it.
That's my question.
Maharaj, I have a question. Maharaj, I have read Gita. So there is, it is being said that Esloka, Ah Brahma, Bhuvanan Loka, Punara Vartino, Arjuna, Mamu Petya Tukumteya, Punar Janma Navidyate.
Correct.
It means you can go to Brahmalok, to Bhuvanlok, everywhere. But you have to retake birth again in Bhuvanlok.
Yes,
so what's the difference between Mamu Petya and the getting Brahmalok? Krishna is saying Mamu Petya. So what does that mean, the Mamupetya? We say that we are Brahma. Is it correct?
Yeah, it is correct. Now, till Brahma Loka, if you go to any other Loka, just like for an example, now you've got some cash in your pocket. Till it is getting exhausted, you can spend. You can buy anything and everything. the moment your pocket is empty, then you will not be able to buy. So similarly, whatever punya you have got accumulated, that is a result of good actions, accordingly you attain, you go to the different, your sukshma sharira and karna sharira will go to the different worlds and you will enjoy. Just like when my pocket is empty, and then I will not be able to spend money or my purchase power will go away and I will have to come back to my house, to my place where I stay. So similarly, once your punya is over, then you have to come back to this bhuloka and you have to start again earning the fruits of action, either good or bad. That's what first line of the shloka tells. And mamu peti punarjanma, naiti mameti sorjuna, when Bhagavan is telling, if you take shelter at my fate, then you will not get, you will not get the punarjanma, you will not get the rebirth. So there, it is told from the point of bhakti yoga. In the bhakti yoga, the worshipper and the worshipped, I am the worshipper and the worshipped is my Ishtadevata or chosen deity. The slowly, 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 with the worship, the moment I go and I understand who is he and what is he, etc., then I will not get a punarjanma. That is what the bhakti schools of Vedanta, they said. So that idea has been told in there. Do you understand that is clear for you?
Yes, Maharaj.
Yeah.
Yes, I have a question.
Yeah.
There is a sentence that Tattvamasi.
Tattvamasi, yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Tattvamasi. So Mahaprabhu, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told it Tat Tasya Asi. Tat Tasya Asi. You are his. And Tattvamasi means you are he. So here is also different between two lines.
Yeah, the same. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is a school of philosophy is called Shuddhadvaita, and Tattvamasi, I am that, you are that, verily, you are that. Tattvamasi, you are that, that's what we say. Tattvamasi, you are that, that's what Advaita school of Vedanta says that. You are that means what? Aham Brahmasmi. You are that, verily, Brahman, that's what we say. And that's what we have accepted and we follow. Whereas Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he deviates from it, or he defines, or he explains in a different way that you are his servant. You are his servant, or you are his son, or whatever it says that. Now, in whichever school of philosophy you believe, just you go in that school of philosophy, you take that path and just you keep continuing. Slowly, slowly, slowly when we go and finally we reach in the same place, all of them. That's what Shyam also tells it, isn't it?
So we have a question from Santosh ji.
Please
unmute yourself and ask the question.
Namaskaram Maharaj.
Namaste Santosh ji.
Maharaj, even suppose the desires of or the achievements of like achieving Brahmaloka or any other Shivaloka or any other events, it is not immediately desirable because it has a arrival date and a departure date there also.
Yes.
Then
it's a good desire.
Maras?
It is a good desire.
Yes, good desire, but there is it's a limited period alone we can enjoy. There is a entry, then there is exit. Then all this knowledge that we are trying to achieve, saying that I am not the mind, I am not the body, I am not the intellect, etc. This knowledge is also arriving at some point. So are we saying that we're going to lose that knowledge at some point later? Because it belongs to the mind. Is it not?
Okay, yes.
Then how can we say complete bliss or complete happiness or complete freedom and security?
Okay, I'll give an example. When you were a small boy, when you were a small kid, probably you demanded from your father saying that I want a bird-shaped biscuit only.
Yes.
Okay, there was one biscuit which was a bird-shaped and you wanted it and your father gave. And your sister or brother, he or she also wanted for that bird-shaped biscuit only. So both of you started crying and both of you started quarreling. Probably your mother or father, your elder, someone might have said, see, either it is a bird-shaped biscuit, or animal-shaped biscuit, or a human-shaped biscuit, or bell-shaped biscuit. It doesn't make any sense because the content is same. Only the name and form is different, my dear boy, my dear girl. So please take this. But we never said, okay, most of us, isn't it? No, I want bird-shaped biscuit only. We cry, sometimes we get beatings, etc., etc. Now you have grown and similar incident may be happening in your house with some your kith and kin or with your relatives, children, whatever. The moment you see, you start laughing at it, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Because it reminds of your childhood pranks.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, so do you say that knowledge has dropped from you? Or you say that you have evolved yourself?
I say I've evolved.
So similarly, I am body, I am mind, I am emotion, I am son of so-and-so, I am the owner of so-and-so, I am owner of such and such a thing, I am the husband of such a lady, I am the wife of such and such a person, etc. All these upadis are also a wrong notion, wrong thinking. Okay, in the business affair and the mundane affair, for every day we have to keep all these things, I don't say no. But in reality, once you advance yourself, once your mind gets advanced, so you will feel that who is all these things, isn't it? Just like as a small boy, you fought for the bird-shaped biscuit. Now you laugh at it. Similarly, when you advance yourself in the spiritual life, or when you intellectually, when you advance yourself, when you emotionally, when you mature yourself, you understand all these upadis or relations are time-bound and it is not real. The reality is what? I am that Atman or I am that Brahman. And that Brahman, that conscious principle exists in everyone and anyone. Isn't it?
Yes.
So it is only transcending ourselves. It is only intellectual growth. It is a paradigm shift. It is not that we are losing something there. Or rather, we are losing the wrong notions, I can say.
Maharaj, there are states like evolving or going from lower truth to higher truth. All these states belong to the mind, not to the Atma.
Yes, definitely. You are very right. Yes.
But then,
because Atman is always that only. It is Atman is Sachit Ananda. It cannot come down for you. Because you have come down, it cannot come to your level. It is always Sachit Ananda only. So whether Bandha and Mukti also from the point of Maya only, from the point of mind only. That's why Manayava Karanam Bandha Moksha Yoho, when you say that, mind is reason. Mind is the reason for Bandha and Moksha. Why? Because the notion of binding, the notion of freedom is for mind, not for the Atman. Atman is ever free. It cannot bind, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am. So, yes, ma'am. All this evolution or all this clarity or freedom is, we are talking about the mind, not the Atma.
No. That's why we say Jivatma. When we Jivatma means because of mind. Mind is also a part of Sukshma Sharira, isn't it? So, all this evolutions is of the mind only, not of the Atman. Atman was there and Atman is there. Atman will be there. There is no change in the state of the Atma. Only there's a change in the state of the mind. Again, emotions, you can say intellectual thinking, you can say whatnot. It is only in the mind, with respect to mind, not with respect to Atman. Yes, you are right.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
Swamiji, we have one question in the chat box.
Yeah.
Read it out.
Please.
So the question is, what is meant by detachment from fruits of action?
Mm-hmm.
Is it freedom from emotional reaction to success and failure? Also, kindly suggest ways of not getting affected by fruits of action and keep one-pointed focus on targets to be achieved.
Okay. Now, this is Bhokta, Karta and Gnata. I took this idea itself, but I didn't explain in detail. Just I made a point and I moved. Bhokta is always a person, a mediocre person, and low-minded people. Always they are bothered about the fruits of actions. For example, now my goal is to become an IAS officer. I want to be an IAS officer. That's my goal. That's my ambition. I should keep struggling. But many of the time, the youngsters, what you will think, okay, if I become IAS officer, what will I become? What will I do? Where I will be posted? What will be my power? How much people will come and listen to me? How much they respect me, etc., etc. With such type of notions only, many times our mind is covered instead of struggling. If I am supposed to be an IAS officer, for example, say 8 to 10 or 12 hours I am supposed to read, I have supposed to mastery over the subjects, and I have to do prelims and mains properly. So my mind always supposed to think about the struggle to achieve my goal, to reach my target and ambitions. Instead of that, we always think, what will happen? What will happen? What will happen? That's where we get deviated from the main pursuit. So we should stop thinking about the fruits of action. Instead, we should struggle, or we should concentrate our mind and our energy, etc., on the efforts. Then automatically this focus comes. For example, if the cricketer, if he starts thinking, if my bowling goes wrong, whether it will be wide or it will be no ball, or whether it will be reason for LBW or mid wicket or whatever, so he will not be able to, he will not be able to do right bowling, isn't it? He's thinking, I will try my best to see that he will not be able to achieve any run, or I will try my best to just make him the opposite person as out. That's all will be his intention, and he will keep struggling. If he's keep intellectually or in the corner of the mind, if he's thinking about, okay, now I will put the ball, he will become out, his mid wicket will go, his LBW, he goes, such type of notions if he has got in his mind, he'll not be able to play better. Isn't it? The moment we get a complete mind in the efforts, then we'll be able to achieve success sooner. That's what quality pursuit we say. So the moment if you focus on your path and forget, once you fix your goal, ambition, you don't bother about fruits of action. Just if you keep on pursuing your path or your efforts in the described path or desired path, you'll be able to achieve the focus and you'll be able to get it once. I'm clear for the person who asked this? Rajasthi Rai Chaudhary. Yeah.
Okay, Swamiji, do we have time for another question?
Yeah.
Okay, so there's one question that is asked by Harpreet Singh. Swamiji, how to have spiritual freedom along with the life, having a reasonable level of money, as often these two are conflicting?
No, they're not yes, that's what in the middle of my talk I told, Vedanta never denies or Vedanta never underestimates the role of money. Vedanta never underestimates the role of food or cloth or shelter, the external accomplishments. You may achieve, we don't say no, but don't stop there. Or don't think that they're the alpha and omega of the life. That's where we have to properly, clearly understand. Because Vedanta says that I'm Brahmasmi from tomorrow onwards. I cannot say it simply, because at some point of time, after right time, then my hungry, when I feel hungry, then I am supposed to eat something. Otherwise, I will get health problems, health issues and all. We have to pursue all these things, but in the limited way. And we should understand what is the role of it and what is the place of this money, clothes, shelter, external accomplishments in my life. The moment you understand, and so much time and energy you give for that, and rest time and energy you give for your spiritual practices, then you'll be able to do spiritual as well as the mundane affairs accomplishment. It can be possible. Because for us, work and worship, work as worship, work is worship. These are the three steps. We should never confuse. Swamiji says, even in Nivedita gives beautifully, she also says in the introduction of complete works of Vekanda, from now onwards, there will be no distinction between sacred and secular. That's what spiritualizing everyday life, we all say. That is the final stage, or that is the little advanced status. Initially, for us, secular and spiritual will be definitely, it will be different only. We need secular and we need spiritual. Both should go hand in hand. Slowly. Once after little amount of struggle, our mind and certain amount of maturity, will be able to understand how to maintain both of these things, then you'll be able to. So because I'm a spiritual person means I should not neglect all these things. I should give a right place for all these things. That's what the spirituality of the Vedanta says that. Is it clear for the person?
Swamiji, I want to...
Yeah?
I want to add to it. Something when you go for spirituality, or when we try to follow our principles,
okay,
it becomes conflicting. If you want to grow in the world, many times you see that you have to compromise with your values.
Okay,
and how to deal with all these things?
But there are the people, they're the outstanding people who followed their values, and also they were able to live in the world. Then you may have to face some troubles. You may have to face some tribulations, no doubt. But leading a life is not a problem for you, isn't it? There are the greater personalities or greatest personalities who followed the values. They had to face some problems, difficulties. I don't say no, but facing all the tribulations and difficulties, they were the achievers, and they have made their own impact on the society. There are a number of examples we can say, isn't it? So if you value the value, then you have to take this risk. You have to take the trouble and you have to follow the values so that your life will have a value. It is not easy, but it is possible. Yeah, one more question is there in the chat box. We know waking, dreaming, deep sleep states. Please tell me about the state of unconsciousness. What is this actually? Now, unconsciousness is I'm not aware of it. Now, when you are sleeping, generally you are unconscious. You don't know what is happening outside. That is one type of unconscious. The other type of unconscious, generally we speak in the psychology, in today modern psychology, is that I am unaware of many things which is in the mind. For an example, you are listening to my talk, that whatever you are listening, that thought current particular pertaining to that connection, it may be going, and some or other thoughts may be lingering in your mind, one or two thoughts. But there are hundreds of thoughts, impressions, which are there in your mind, which you are not aware of it. And because your mind is unconscious, larger part of your mind is unconscious. That is what unconscious we mean in generally. Yeah. I hope questions are over.
Yeah. Yes. So we had a hand raised from Sanchit Gupta. So Sanchit, do you want to go?
Hello. So I was asking, like Maharaj, you were talking about some experience, that once you have that experience, you are will have that knowledge that you are one with everything else in the universe.
Mm-hmm.
So which experience are we talking about? And if it's really an experience, then isn't it transitory? Won't the mind come back to normal state and then behave in a normal way? Or are we referring to the knowledge that we gain after that experience, so that that knowledge remains throughout the entire day? So could you please elaborate on that?
Yeah. See, the moment this Sri Ramakrishna beautifully gives an example, an example or an explanation for this. Now, I don't know what is there in the terrace or what is made up of terrace. Actually, I didn't know this. May I, a small boy, as an inquisitiveness, just I climbed the steps and I reached the terrace. After going to the terrace, I understood whatever the materials which we used to construct the steps, the same material has also been used to construct the terrace also. So materially, there is no difference between either on the terrace or then the steps. So both are same. So that's what we understand. Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma. Earlier, Aham Brahmasmi. I am that Brahman. I was thinking. I was trying to meditate or water upasana, etc. And as a matter of fact, it became my experience that I am that Brahman. And slowly afterwards, I will understand that I am not that only Brahman. In the world, whatever is there, everything is Brahman. So first is Aham Brahmasmi, afterwards Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma. For explanation only, I am telling that as a one after another, but it happens simultaneously. The moment you understand you are that Brahman, and you will not be there to tell, okay, I am that Brahman, what about you? I am that Brahman, what about he? I am that Brahman, what about she? There will be no one person extra differently to tell who is he. When he comes down from that state of experience, then when he sees the duality of the world, then he understands that whatever I was understanding, I was experiencing about this world, which was wrong, and it may be, he sees auditorium as auditorium, he may see as a people as a people, but as a behind it, everything he tries to see as a Brahman. Isn't it? Just for one more example, I will give you to make you just clear. For example, rope. You can tie the rope. You can tie the people and etc. Once the rope was thrown somewhere and accidentally it got the fire, and after the fire it got completely burnt. But since the rope was not shaken anywhere, the same mark, just how it was left there before getting burned. Similarly, it is there. If you to see outside, the shape is there, but inside the ropeness has gone. It has become ash. If you touch, you will understand that it is a clump of ash, it is not the rope. From such type of rope, you will not be able to tie anyone or anything, isn't it? So before understanding that I am Brahman or other Brahman, I was perceiving the world in different. The moment I understand that I am Brahmasmi, and either what I perceive others will be totally different. I may be behaving with you as, for example, you are so-and-so. For argument's sake, that you are Gadadhar. Okay, Gadadhar, how are you? Would you like to have a cup of coffee? I will, as soon as you come to my ashrama, I will ask you, I will give a cup of coffee as a matter of courtesy. But I will not be, I will no more deluded by that, by your body-mind complex on what. So in the vyavahara gnana, in the vyavahara, whatever we are supposed to do in the mundane affairs will maybe continuing our thing, but in heart of heart, in the behind of all these things, only Brahman is the truth and everything is Brahman. Other than Brahman, there is nothing else. Yeah, the realized person's experience will be there. Is it clear for you?
Yes, Maharaj. So, Maharaj, do we have to have that experience or can we take it on faith, given that Sri Ramakrishna says that, Ramana Maharishi says that, and if we...
Okay, that's one way of that, because Ramana Maharishi said, Sri Ramakrishna said, Swami Vivekananda said, Upanishad said, all these things, scriptures have said, and the people like Sri Ramakrishna, Swami Vivekananda questioned Sri Ramakrishna, have you seen God? Sri Ramakrishna said, yes, I have seen God and I can show you if you want, if you are interested. So based on these people's statement, because they were all realized persons, they have seen God, they have spoken with the God and they have experienced all that, based on that also we can go ahead. Otherwise also think logically. If you think logically, if you can go on, think logically, you will be able to understand. Yes, it is true.
Yes,
ma'am. You need not to accept that God and etc. But still you can understand who are you. Even agnostic or atheist also take the Gnana path, path of knowledge, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
That is the beauty of even Jivan Mukti. For Jivan Mukta, you need not to be a bhakta. You need not to accept the existence of God. Without that also, you can try to understand yourself or try to take the path of this Jivan Mukta sthiti. Because there it said that you are, that your real nature is what? That's what we are trying to tell you, my brother.
Yes. Thank you, Maharaj.
Yeah.
Swamiji, we have one more question.
Okay.
From, yeah, if you have time.
Yeah.
Srimaiji, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Thank you, Maharaji, for your wonderful talk.
Thank you.
I actually had a question related to what Sanchit just asked, his first question. Mm-hmm. So we understood about freedom here and now, enlightenment, consciousness, these things from you at an intellectual level.
Yes.
To actually realize it, you said that we need that scrubbing, the outer layer has to come off, such things. But like the sandalwood paste, the sandalwood piece, does the little by little that cover falls off, or is realization or this freedom a certain... Is it an event that happens at a certain point of time, like a eureka moment, or is it a gradual
process? Okay. It's a beautiful question. This is discussed in Vedanta Sara and many Advaitic texts. It's a very technical question too. To understand in the layman's language, I will try to put you that removing the dirt, cleansing your mind, that goes little by little only. But understanding that who are you, realizing it just at one point of time, as an event, or you can say as an event or whatever, at just at some point only you will understand who are you, that's all. It doesn't happen gradually, process by process, little by little, it doesn't happen. The cleaning process will happen little by little, but the understanding who are you, or the realizing or the experiencing who are you or who am I, it happens at some point of time.
Okay, Maharaj. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that's all questions, I believe. Anyway, it is a good thing for me also, because such type of philosophical questions are very rare indeed. I had a good audience and good listeners too. Good questions too. Thank you for all of you.
So, yeah, Swamiji, I had one question, like, if we can end with that.
Okay, go ahead.
So, yes, sir. So, we know, like from your talk or from Vedanta, we know what is to be achieved, like what is the purpose of life?
Mm-hmm.
Self-realization.
Yeah.
So, attaining that truth. So, we know at an intellectual level, we understand that. So, how to follow that? So, let's say we understood, like, let's say we know what to be do, what to be done, what should be done.
Mm-hmm.
But because we are living in the world with senses, having some power towards the outer world, the question is how to move inward when we are living here.
you carry over whatever your external accomplishments in the mundane world, whatever you are supposed to do as your duties, responsibilities. Okay, that's the one thing. And don't try to get attached to all these things. Don't try to allow your mind, allow the world to leave the impressions on you. Like Sri Ramakrishna also came, Sri Ramakrishna also did sadhana, Sri Ramakrishna also tried to uplift all of us, and he passed away, but there was no mental impression created on him. Similarly with the Swami Vivekananda, we can see, similarly with the life events of great people. Swami Vivekananda traveled to the West and he faced a lot of tribulations, he had to face a lot of disasters in his life, he had to experience and he had to witness a lot of adverse circumstances, and character assassination was tried by many Christian monks, I mean fathers and etc. etc. All these things he had to face, and he tried to help the people, tried to help the mankind and world. All his things as an avatara, as incarnation, whatever he was supposed to do, and whatever his master had instructed, everything he did, but nothing was created an impression in him. That's why he was a Mukta Purusha always. He was Mukta Purusha, is, and he will be, that's why. Because he was a Mukta Purusha always. So similarly, you may continue your affairs, you may continue your work and all, but you see that should not create any new impulses, or that should not create any new impressions on your mind. That is the first thing, which we are supposed to take care of in our life, one thing. And second thing, whatever has been created by sadhana, by tapas, by bhakti yoga, by jnana yoga, or by karma yoga, we are supposed to clean our mind. By karma yoga, chitta shuddhi happens, cleaning the mind. By upasana or bhakti yoga, according to the Advaita Vedanta, pure Advaita Vedanta, Shankara Advaita Vedanta, I am telling, according to upasana or meditation, will get chitta ikagrata. And by jnana yoga, shravanam nidhyasana, who I am, that hearing and cogitating on that, meditating on that, I will understand, and that brahmakara vritti comes, and brahmakara vritti will remove the ignorance, or destroy the ignorance, and one fine day I will understand who am I. That is what the scheme of evolution of the sadhana is given by Adi Shankaracharya in his all scriptures, Bhashya, commentaries on scriptures, whatever he has told. In that he tells, first you start with the karma yoga, then bhakti yoga, then dhyana yoga. It is not one by one. Simultaneously, you should keep doing it. One after another, it will take care of our life. By karma yoga, you will get chitta shuddhi. By bhakti yoga, upasana, you will get ekagrata. And by dhyana yoga, your ignorance is destroyed. Is it clear for you?
Yes, Swamiji. So, okay, like we do our mundane work, so we have certain worldly targets to it will be there.
Yeah, so let it be there.
As scripture says, do not have desires.
Yes. As a sense of responsibility and duty you do. For example, you are a family man. Now you understand that you are that Atman or Brahman, that is the, I am supposed to experience and supposed to understand and I am supposed to experience, that is the real goal of life. Now I am a married person, I have got a family, what should I do with family now? Definitely you are a family person, as a sense of duty and responsibility, you take care of your parents and take care of your kith and kin wife, but don't get attached to that. That's what the Vedanta says, that's what the scripture says.
Okay, thank you, Swamiji. So yeah, we are grateful to you, Swamiji, for taking out your time.
I thank
you on behalf of VSC. And those willing to join VSC, please again type your email address in the chat box and we'll add you. Now we'll end the session with a Santi Mantra by Srimay Mukherjee.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Harih Om Sat Sat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu. Jai Shri Ramakrishna.
Jai Shri Ramakrishna.
Jai Ramakrishna.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Yeah, can I quit?
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yes, yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Maharaj.